Hello and welcome to another episode of Mortgage Video Mastermind, where we bring you professionals who share insight into the latest trends, tips, industry, technology, and services to help you create more videos to use in your mortgage business. Well, hey there, happy Friday, and we want to welcome you to our Mortgage Video Mastermind live call. And my name is Ginger Bell. I have one, the only, Frazier. And it looks like we've got Carl White, who has hopped on. There he is.
How are you doing, my friend?
How are you?
I'm doing well. I'm in a sleazy bar in Houston, Texas.
Perfect.
And that's how every story should start, right?
That's how every.
What do they say? No good story start. So I was having a salad one time.
Yeah.
Well, very good. Well, thanks so much for hopping on. Totally appreciate it. And if it's me, we're getting feedback. I'm not on anything.
Yeah, I'm hearing a lot of like somebody's at a party or something.
Oh, I wonder if it's me. Let me switch to something else. Some mat on the floor.
Oh. Right. Well, that's so while you do that, normally it's me that is doing something like that. So we figured out how to do the whole Facebook thing. So we'll continue to see if we can get some of that background sound out. There you go. It's much better. Thanks, Fraser. Okay.
Is that better?
Yeah, that's much better.
All right. Perfect.
No more bar sounds. We would expect that from you, Carl.
I know. See, I thought. Okay, wait. I'm literally at a bar, but there's nobody here but me. So.
There we go.
I'm loving the paneling. So, are there any kind of trophy heads up on the walls or anything like that?
No, actually, it's a cigar bar. I was just driving down the road looking for a place. We just did an event yesterday, and my flight leaves here in like a couple hours. And I thought it was going to be too noisy at the airport. So I found this cigar bar, and I thought, who in the hell sits in a cigar bar at 11:30 in the morning? Should be nobody. And I was right, so there's nobody here. So
nice. Well, and that kind of tees it up for what I wanted to talk about today, and that is telling stories.
Mm.
So it's one of those things that sometimes we forget the importance of telling stories, and especially in video. And so just like you're talking about, where you are, what you're doing there, and why, obviously you went there, found it, this is why you're doing it. But really the story begins with that, and then where it goes is up to you. And we have so many stories that people can tell in our business, from whether it's loan scenarios, whether it's helping a veteran, whether it's helping a first-time home buyer, all of those things are great stories to tell. And, Carl, I know you have probably done some videos as far as talking about a story and telling a story. So can you give us an idea of some of the things that you've done?
So some of the things that I've done is we don't want to, I mean, it's okay to tell our own stories, at some degree, but not that much. I think it's important from time to time, because you want your database, and whether a database is your past database or your prospects or your referral partners, or prospective referral partners, you want them to get to know you. So I think it's important at some level to tell your story, and little snippets. But my favorite is just the good old testimonials, Ginger, and it's basically those same things that we post on Facebook. Like when somebody goes to, if at a title company helped a new family move into a house, tell their story about how they got moved in.
Right.
And so those are real good for me. I got a question for you, Ginger.
It's the perfect timing for that, right? Always the perfect timing.
And now that's what we call Is that a dangling participle?
Yeah. dramatic pause.
Dramatic. Yeah. I have a question for you. What?
Yeah,
I have a question for you.
Yeah. So
what
I think
is the question?
So when you do when you tell stories on video, how long of a story is it? Like in minutes? Like what? Like are we talking about a 2-3 minute story? Are we talking about a 15 minute story? Like for you, what kind of time frame are you looking at?
You know, so there's, and again, you know, I always say this: there's no right or wrong answer. Yeah. I think it depends on what you're using it for. So if you're telling a story about a home buyer and, you know, you're sitting at the signing table, and that's a great opportunity, bring your phone along. First of all, two things I would recommend. Get a release signed with all of your borrowers, especially if you're meeting them face-to-face, to be able to take a video of them, get that release so that you can do that and you can share that. So that's the first thing. And if you guys want a copy of a release, I'm happy to post it. We can post it down below that we give to our clients that are just standard. So that's the first thing. Second thing, always bring your phone with you and bring something to record on, something to set it on. And as you're sitting there waiting, because you know, you get into title, what are you doing? You're sitting waiting. And so use that time. And I always recommend having an idea as far as what you're going to do to frame that story up. And so you could sit down doing the signing and you can say, you know, hey, it's Ginger Bell with ABC Mortgage. And today I'm sitting here with Jason Frazier, Carl White. We're getting ready to sign their closing documents. And while we're sitting here waiting, I'd like to be able to share with you really their story, their journey that's gotten us to this point. So, you know, Jason, you know, you and I met for the first time and you were looking for that first time home. So, you know, tell me, you know, what does this feel like right now at this moment as you're getting ready to sign those papers? What are you feeling? And let them share the story. But if you kind of have a list of questions, you know, what are you feeling right now? How is the process? You know, were you scared? Were you nervous? Are you excited? And then, you know, think about how you're going to close that. It's like, okay, after we get done with closing, what's the first thing you're going to do? Are you going to run out? Are you going to, you know, hoot and holler? Are you going to run over and open that? I mean, think about that. Part of it is leading them on that journey as well. And so really being able to do that and frame it up to have that story is so important. So that's the first thing I would recommend. Timing for that, couple minutes, just a couple minutes. Now, if you are, you know, working on something that's a longer project, that could be a longer video. Like right now we have a client that's doing a renovation of two brothers and they inherited the home that they grew up in and their parents passed away 4 years ago, home's in a trust, and they're totally they're taking it all the way down, redoing the whole thing. That's not a 2 minute story. That's a longer story. So we're framing that up and we're breaking it into parts. So it depends on what it is. I can tell you YouTube, as far as what they like time-wise to see, is videos over 7 minutes. So if you want to, you know, plan on building your YouTube channel and posting videos there, then you want to get a little bit longer. And then you can get creative. You know, you can, you know, do a series on, you know, helping military families get into homes. And, you know, you can just make it a plan that you sit down with them and you tape the first interview, you do a, you know, point, you touch point with them, and then you do the end video. And then, and if you don't want to do it, hire a videographer, have someone go out and videotape them walking into the door, walking through the door, walking into the home for the first time. Because that's what we call B-roll video that we can put in underneath somebody talking, that is that visual. So the story is not just somebody sitting down. A lot of it is taking them along that journey, and you can do that by, you know, creating some of those other types of B-roll videos with you're sitting down with an interview, you know, you're having those conversations. If you're doing a renovation, maybe they're looking at what they're going to do to the home, you know, whatever that is. It can be them packing. I mean, there's so many things you can do with it to be able to have that. You could even have the realtor involved with it. I don't think enough people are doing that two branded type marketing with their real estate agents, where they have a plan in place and, you know, they're going out with somebody looking at homes. You know, what is it like looking at homes? What are they looking for? So those I would recommend, you know, if you're going to do something that is a little bit longer story, you're going to get it produced, it's going to have some B-roll, I would recommend pushing it over 7 minutes to be able to really get into the story.
You know, in essence, what you're describing, it sounds like a lot of it is something that have you ever heard the term future casting or future pacing by chance?
Yeah.
So for those of that might be listening, it's not familiar with that. Future casting or future pacing, it's two words that mean the exact same thing, is like a real high level tool of influence. And basically what we're doing on our prospect is, if you can get somebody to imagine they already have the results that that you want to help them get, man, people take action on that like really fast. So in this instance where we're talking about like buying houses, telling a story, like if I was telling a story about my brother Jason here, and about how finished serving with the armed forces, and he's moving here to Houston, Texas, and helped me welcome him. And he's buying his first house, and it's got a Jason. Man, I love the pool that's in your backyard, and man, I can smell that barbecue now, and like the kids out there, you know, playing in the pool. And what I'm trying to do here is, not just with Jason, but with my listeners, I want them to like be smelling the barbecue and feeling the water splashing on their face, like in their mind. And they think, man, maybe we could get a pool home too. And then when we're, you know, when I'm doing that short story with Jason, you know, we're just like, for me, it's always important just to pan out like Jason's just a regular dude like me.
Right.
He's just a regular person like you are, Ginger. Well, a little bit of superwoman involved, but you know, Jason's just a normal person. And so in all my storytelling, I'm trying to get I'm future pacing or future casting my audience for them to imagine, hey, I can have this too. Carl helped Frazier. Frazier seemed like a nice guy. I'm a nice guy or a nice lady. Maybe that can help me too. And so I think that future casting and future pacing is a real powerful thing. Hey, so let me ask you something. On this 7-minute YouTube thing, I've heard you mention that before. And to be honest with you, I forgot about it. That's very interesting. So do you go so far as, like, when you're picking the different platforms, are you looking at the different time frames? Like, if I'm doing it on Facebook, should I plan it a little shorter and YouTube a little longer? Or you do it, it is what it is.
It is what it is.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, so here's, I mean, if you're really, you know, if you're really getting into building numbers and, you know, you want to do be like a Kyle Seagraves and, you know, build a big following on YouTube, then you're going to concentrate on doing longer videos.
Yeah.
And you can post those on Facebook and you can put those. But honestly, I think the most important thing in doing videos is to have an idea. Even if you just do one video a week and you make out a plan, it's like, okay, I'm going to do one consumer video. I'm going to do one realtor video.
Yeah.
I'm going to do one social video. So community, you know, whatever that is. And then I'm going to do one that is a story. So a borrower story. And if you do that and then you always know which of those buckets you are working on, it makes it a lot easier. Some will be 2 minutes. Some will be 7 minutes. Some may be 17 minutes, you know, depending on what you're going. I had a conversation with an LO yesterday who is a certified divorce specialist. And so she has a ton of information to be able to share. Probably not going to get a lot of those videos done in 2 minutes. She may do some, but some of them will be longer. So I wouldn't worry about the time, and I wouldn't even worry about the venue. I would just say get started, but have an idea of what categories you're going to do, because then that makes it easy for you to plan it. And that's always what I recommend. Here's your buckets. Here's what I'm going to do. Plan it out each month. Here's my four topics and go from there. You know, Frazier's really good at doing this. And I know you do a lot in the marketing that you do, is to be able to say, okay, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this and this. And that's kind of what you did when you started doing your podcast too, that you did. It's like, this is what we're going to focus on, right?
Yeah, and just to add to the timing, and this is where, you know, because we've all heard of like, oh, your video should be under, and I just talked about this at the Vision Summit last week, is that, or a few days ago, I forgot it's Friday, but it's like, people are like, oh, your video should be like 60 seconds, 90 seconds, whatever, because of people's attention span, and that's actually not true. Yes, attention spans are going down, but here's the thing, is like, when you start with your video, the first thing you need to understand is that it needs to be compelling. Right. If 2 minutes and I think the exact number is like 2 minutes and 52 seconds. When they actually looked at the data, it wasn't because of attention span that was the average time. Is that was how long people could tolerate something they weren't really interested in. Right. So which is in itself, because then what we're doing is we're producing content based off of tolerance, and nobody wants to do that. I'm not just trying to be tolerable. I want to be compelling. Right. So you got to be thinking about what's going to be compelling, because here's the thing. If 2 minutes and 52 seconds was like what the sweet spot was, then that would be the most popular videos on YouTube. And it's not. The average time on YouTube is 15 minutes. So that is what you should be going for. And honestly, your audience is going to tell you whether it's the length is too long or too short, right? If people want more, then they're going to be on. The time on video is going to be longer, right? So that thing, and I love what Carl said in the beginning about the story aspect of it, and because that's so true, is when I get in the conversation with loan officers about how much mortgage content I should be doing, I'm like, if you're going to do mortgage content, tell stories. Tell stories about the family you just helped. Tell stories about, because you're going to, like to Carl's point, you're going to create commonality, because like, hey, I'm in that same situation. They don't care about you as a loan officer about like, hey, I did this loan today. Great. Tell me the story about Frank and Linda, who I just helped, who didn't know that they were just a few points away on their credit to get to the right loan program that was going to help them. Right. And actually Carl's really great at that, because the last event I was at with Carl, I think was UAMP, and Carl was talking about, and it wasn't really a testimonial, but it was a story, but in a sense it was a testimonial, because Carl was telling the story about, I can't remember her name, but about how like it really changed her life, about where she was slaving away. And now she's has more time with her family, more time to go on vacations, more time, and she's not a slave to the business, right? And that was a complete story. Nowhere in that story did Carl say, I did this, I did that, I was doing all that stuff. He just simply told a story, but in a sense saying, oh, well, I'm in that same situation. I need to talk to Carl to figure out what that is. And if a loan officer would just do that, as it relates to them and their borrowers, they could do all the mortgage content they want, and it would be compelling, because you're telling good stories about actual people and situations that you made better.
You know, Frazier, that's a great point that you said there, that you want to make sure that you don't go in and tell them the stories, just like what you said, I this and I helped them this, and we worked on them for a little while and we did this, or, you know, because as you're telling the, as, like it, like if I'm telling a story about you, Frazier, of how I started hanging out with you, and then you could suddenly start to levitate and fly around.
Yeah.
You know, the watcher, the viewer is going to insert in my name into making that happen automatically. Like just because I'm sitting there and telling the story, like in a cool way, like when you're telling these stories about your clients, you are going to get credit for helping them make that happen. Cause like as a loan officer, a branch manager, mortgage professional, you are the one that helped make that happen. But everybody's going to know that, and their mind is going to automatically insert that part of the story in. So as long as you're telling the story, you don't have to, me and my team, we this and we that, cause that starts to sound uncool. Cause see, that, then the story, and that's what you're saying, is the story starts becoming about me, and it's not, it's about them. And everybody will automatically interject you as the one that helped them do that. So that's a great point.
So true. Right here.
Yeah, great point.
So true. Thank you.
Yeah, and I think working, and depending on, you know, where you're at, you don't have to be an originator. It can be anything in your business to be able to bring in, you know, a customer. It's like Frazier, you know, EPM, great wholesale lender. So bringing in, and you do a good job of this, to be able to bring in brokers to tell their story and how they're building their business. Carl, you do a great job of that. So think about your customers, and then also about your partners. So, you know, if you want to build business with real estate agents, the best way to do that is to have a real estate agent tell their story of working with you and what that was like. And, you know, you can sit down. I mean, you could do something like what we're doing right now, to where, you know, you just have a conversation. You say, you know, hey, Fraser, absolutely love everything that you do in your business. You know, one of the things that I know you're really committed to is providing that great customer service. And we just finished getting an incredible buyer into a home, and that was the Smiths. So, you know, what was important to the Smiths when they got started looking at a home? And if you become really good at helping people tell their stories, you become a part of that story. And, you know, Fraser, I love the fact you remembered the story that Carl told. Couldn't remember the person's name. That's irrelevant, right?
Yep.
But what you remember is the story. And that's what people remember. People remember stories. So
exactly.
Talk about how you can do that, pulling your partners in. You know, if you want to be able to attract more real estate agents, have real estate agents tell their story. Tell their story and their buyer stories and their seller stories. And maybe it was a problem that you solved. And instead of sitting there saying, hey, Fraser, you know, we just closed another deal. Hoo-hoo, high five, you know. You know, in that home, that was a beautiful home, you know, blah, blah, blah. It was blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Means nothing to anyone.
Nothing.
Right?
Yeah.
But if I say, you know, Fraser, we just helped the Smiths get into their home. And, you know, one of the things that they were looking for was a comfort home, something that was going to be their forever home. What was important? And you can still guide them through the process of selling themselves, right? But you do that with that undertone of the stories. That's why documentaries are so big. I mean, you look at documentaries. Documentaries are some of the best selling tools that are out there.
That's a great point.
So I'm doing
a series now, just started doing them, and I don't even know if they've been released yet, and I call them Coffee with Carl.
Nice.
Yeah, and so I'm sitting in my, and they might have been released, they might have started releasing, I'm not sure, but I sit in my kitchen of my house, and it's very well lit, you know, and I've got, in this case, a lady. One somebody that works with me, and what we do is we go on Facebook into some of these home buying groups where the consumers are, right?
Right.
And we go look to see what questions they ask, and the ones that get the most responses from the other people say, hey, I have a question here, and the one that gets, you know, 158 people responding back, you know, trying to help them out, I go, all right, that's a good question, apparently.
I love it.
So then I look at that. I look at that question. I look at the responses, and I think, all right, when's a time? How can I? Who have I had that had that similar situation? You know, so that I can now tell a story about that. I didn't even know I was doing this until you started talking about the story stuff. So then I think, oh, you know what, man, that situation reminds me just like the Smiths.
Right.
And so then we turn on the camera, and this is a single shot. It's literally my iPhone on a little tripod with a little ring light, right?
And then remember, because we talked about this, we hold it horizontal.
Horizontal, that's right. and then the person that's interviewing me, in this case, it's Lauren. Lauren will say, well, Carl, I know a lot of people ask about insert in question that we saw on Facebook that had a lot of, you know, had a lot of attention. How would you answer that? I said, well, you know, that's a great question. I remember I had a client, and if I haven't specifically asked them, is it okay if I tell this story? Which most of the time I don't. So most of the time, you know, on that type of situation, I said, I had a client not too long ago. It was a couple, and they were buying a house, and they found this certain situation, and here's what we ended up doing with them and how it all turned out, you know, well. And basically it's kind of like a, you know, small town girl makes good kind of thing, you know, like how everything worked out, you know, or a hero's journey, I guess, probably better, about how everything worked out. But I get a lot of my questions and a lot of my ideas on these Facebook group pages where the consumers are going and posting questions, and whichever one's most interesting. And I get some ideas from some of the answers they do. I go, man, that's a pretty good idea. And I literally swipe it off of those pages, turn off the camera, and off we go. So that's got some, and those are about, I would say they're averaging probably on the low side, 3 minutes, on the high side, probably about 8 minutes or 9 minutes, maybe 10, something like that.
And where are you
We're going to be on Facebook.
Okay.
Right. So what we do is we get our past database and we upload our past database into Facebook, and then we target those ads to our past database. Same thing. We get a list of all the qualified agents, all the well producing real estate agents in our area. We got that list also. Upload that into Facebook and then run ads to them. So when we have that video, it's only being seen by people that are in our past database or real estate agents in our case. And we also, if you have you're pre-approved in Lookings without looking for a house, you can do the exact same thing with them.
Yeah.
I love Facebook.
Yes, and Facebook is great. There's other venues, and YouTube has really grown in terms of the ads that you can put in there.
Yeah.
And so, those are things too. Start a YouTube channel. It's
which,
free.
Which, by the way, so let me tell you something. You guys might know about this trick. So we just started working into YouTube. Starting to get serious about YouTube, and actually, you're the one that inspired me, Ginger. I think the other week we were on one of these, and you mentioned YouTube's the number two search engine, and second only to Google. I went, damn, how come Everybody knows YouTube. Why aren't I doing that? So one of my concerns with YouTube in the past has been, well, when my video is done, YouTube pops up another video, and what if it's something that I don't agree? Yeah. And so somebody shared me a little hack that I just, so simple, I freaking love. Actually, it was Lauren in my office. She said, well, Carl, all you got to do is once the video's over, have your logo or give us a call to help you as a screenshot and just let that run for 30 seconds.
Yep.
Nobody's going to sit there and wait and watch that for full 30 seconds.
Exactly.
So if there's another following ad of something that I might not agree with or might not want my audience to see, they're going to click off of my video because they got 30 seconds of basically dead space. So I'd never heard, I mean, you guys might be very familiar with that.
I was just about to say that as you were talking about that same thing. Right. And then there's also ways for those that are embedding the YouTube video in their site. There's ways to embed it correctly so they don't get, after it's over, they get a bunch of stuff, because I've had that, Carl, same thing. I've had that where, yeah, I've done a video and the next thing was something that I'm like, oh wow, like that's not something like that I want like associated. Yeah. And then I'm thinking, okay, what kind of keywords am I using? Like, what did I do in my video to say like, this would be the great video to go like after mine. So true. But that's a great, great, great hack.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there's things you can do too, to key up another video. So you can make a recommendation that says, if you like this video, you can, click on this video and then you can lead them down another path. So, there's things that you can do, to be able to do that. But if nothing else, yeah, put the long bumper on at the end, and that can definitely help. And here's the thing. Same thing happens on Facebook. I mean, they go to other stuff and, they...
Wait. You're telling me after they watch my video, they have the audacity to watch somebody else?
And something else comes up.
How dare they?
So I think consumers are getting a lot savvier about that, and I know a lot of people are on Vimeo. It's like, and depending on how tight your compliance is at your organization, they'll be like, oh, I'm not going on Facebook because of the reason you're saying, right? So they go on Vimeo. Vimeo does the same thing, and it's not searched by people. So, I mean, I'm really big on stop doing stuff on Vimeo. If you want it to be found by other people, if it's not something that's specific to, corporate or training, get it out there and just start doing it. Because here's the win side of that. So maybe something else comes up and maybe it's a really bad cat video, but they've watched your video. So that's really what matters, is that they've watched your video. So that's what I always say. Talking about time and YouTube, and we're just about at our 30 minutes. I threw a video up that I had done an interview with an underwriter years ago, and ran across it, wanted to send a link to him. It's like, hey, look what I found. Oh, I'll send you a link. He didn't have a YouTube channel. And I put nothing in there. There's no keywords. There's no searches. I think the description was, here's an interview with an underwriter. That was it. I don't even know how many thousands of views I've had on that. How many comments? And Fraser, I'm still getting emails from people saying they want an underwriting job. So if anyone's hiring underwriters, let me know. And it's just crazy. I mean, it's I did not expect to do anything with this video other than put it up there and send a link to a friend that I did the interview with. That was it. And it's had thousands of views, hundreds of comments. And I put my contact information in there because Fraser and I were working on a project together for underwriting training. And I said, hey, you know, I may have someone that's hiring underwriters. And so I get a couple a week from people saying, hey, I watched your video. And they watch like all 18 minutes of it. Nothing fancy. It's me sitting down with an underwriter talking about what happens in underwriting. That was it. So, I mean, you just never know. That's what's so crazy. It's like, we're not in the minds of people knowing what they're searching for. So take a chance, you know, try it.
Totally.
I think we've lost Carl for a minute here.
Yep,
oh, we did. Yep. At least it was a good freeze phase.
Yeah, it was a good freeze time. Yeah.
Very good. So you know what? I'm not seeing any questions. If you guys do have questions, obviously there's going to be a replay. Type those in there. That's part of creating the entire Facebook group was to be able to, oh, he's back. It was a good freeze space.
It was a good freeze. It was, yeah.
Oh, it's
no, I was going to say I did it again.
All right.
So, okay, so we're at the half an hour, and I'm not seeing any questions, but if you guys do have questions, if you're watching the replay of this, and we're getting a lot of you watching the replay, type those in there. We look for that, and then let us know what additional topics you want. We've got some speakers. We're going to start getting some other people on to talk about videos they're doing. Mindset, Renee Rodriguez is going to be joining us on the 25th, talk about mindset. And that's the whole reason we started this, is just to be able to help you. So let us know. Carl, thank you. I look forward to seeing you in a couple weeks in Utah.
I look forward to it too. I don't know if you can still hear me okay. Apparently this sleazy cigar bar that I found here on the way to the airport, the internet connection seems to be a little iffy. But I really appreciate you guys. Fraser, it's a pleasure as always. Thanks so much for all the great tips, brother.
Absolutely. Awesome.
Okay, thanks, Fraser. I'll be in town next week and I'll be in Atlanta, so drink time.
All right, absolutely.
Okay, thanks.
All right. Bye. Bye.